And we're live. Got about 10 seconds. Everyone off.
Warning, you are about to listen to the greatest radio show ever. And due to contractual obligations and to shield our airwaves and corporate licensees from any semblance of liability, responsibility, and gullibility, we must tell you the views represented on this show are not necessarily those of this station or its management. This radio show contains differing points of view on current political topics, and due to the nature of its contents, it should be heard by everyone. Thank you for listening. 3, 2, 1. Now live from the Devil Radio Studios in Madison, Wisconsin, where the political party is just beginning. Welcome to the Devil's Advocate Show. Friends proving it's never personal, only politics.
Please allow me to introduce myself.
Here is your host, Mike Crute.
Welcome to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show. Dumb, I'm calling this Crudy Does DC. And I'm so confused because I can see you in the Madison studios, the Solidarity Realty studios. You're there with Nate, but here I am. I told you I'd go to DC and I'd bring you back a speaker of the house.
Yeah, man. You should stay there until they get a new one. I'm not real fond of this one. Good to see you, Mike, on the road. I'm going to call it Crudy calling it in. Nate, working the board. Thank you, sir, our fair audience. Happy, happy days to us all.
Calling it in. Buddy, I have been on a walking tour. I have been busting my ass here in the District of Columbia. Never did I know when I planned my day today, Dem, I'd be walking headlong into an election, a successful election of a guy, Mike Johnson? Question mark? Who is this guy? Mike Johnson. Never. My wife's like, Mike's Johnson? What?
Who? What? What?
Yes. It is no reference to me in any way, shape, or form. But there is a Speaker of the House, Dom, a successful vote all the way through the Republican crazy caucus. And did I mention to you, Dom, I got a little brush with fame today. Congresswoman Lauren Boebert, pastor on the street.
Oh, did you get a little brush like the theater brush, or how close were you to the congresswoman?
Well, you know, there was no actual contact, but
all right,
I feel like she gave me a look, Dom. I feel like she was giving me a look. Anyways, Dom, I also saw our mutual friend Gwen Moore. Congresswoman Gwen Moore had a nice chat with her.
Nice.
Out in front of the Longworth building. And I had a local cop, he's eyeballing me. And I'm standing outside, you know, and I'm at this press conference waiting to see if there's going to be gray smoke or white smoke coming out of the Capitol Dome. And apparently it's white smoke success, although maybe black smoke, Dom. I'm not exactly sure how you would signify this new speaker-elect Mike Johnson. But eventually I ran out of time. I had an appointed meeting with Mark Pocan, and he was on the floor voting. And oh, one other admission. Guess who wasn't in the Congress today, Dom?
Derek Van Orden. Yes, he's out saving the world over in Israel, still serving his foreign constituents.
Well, then he will miss the initial vote under the new speakership of Mike Johnson, a bipartisan vote in support of Israel, probably about 2 weeks too late in the coming, according to Mark Pocan. Did I mention I interviewed my congressman, our mutual friend, Mark Pocan, and you're going to hear that interview at 4:30 Central Time for you Midwesterners, you Wisconsinites. You know, I'm out here on the leftist.
Yes, you're the elite. I guess, you're the elitist now, Crudy.
I have been, you know, playing a little political, you know, looking for my political heroes. And the only one I've been really impressed to see, other than Gwen, and of course Mark Pocan, and again, we'll bring you the sound of my interview, Mark Pocan, immediately coming off the House floor, and the interview immediately after the election of new Speaker Mike Johnson. But I saw John Fetterman yesterday. I was walking around D.C. I was here with Mrs. Crute. She's got her own big show coming on tonight. the empowered caregiver, live from D.C. I'm actually her plus one, Dom. she's here for a National Caregiver Conference and is doing a live broadcast from this beautiful hotel, the Royal Sonesta, Capitol Hill. I didn't know I was staying in such nice accommodations, but I am literally within walking distance to the Hill. At least yesterday I was.
You know, listen to this guy. He's staying at the really nice hotel in D.C., drags me out to Vegas for a dem debate, and I got to stay at the Circus, man. I mean, those rooms were so cheap, I think they paid me to stay there.
Well, there was less clear damage on the on the spreads and much less smoking smell yeah. in the actual hotel here. A very modern, I got to tell you, the staff here, I feel like a big shot, Dom. I have been pampered by the staff. They're very polite, very friendly, Midwestern nice, you might say. But maybe they're all just excited because we've got a Speaker of the House. But as I was walking through the Capitol Hill yesterday, my wife and I did a little self-guided walking tour of D.C., saw John Fetterman sitting on a park bench on the Capitol Hill grounds. And, you know, I was dying to walk up and introduce myself, Dom, but... You know, the guy seemed so chill there. He was like, it was like an outside recess day. You know what it's like yesterday? Wisconsin had that beautiful weather. Well, who wants to rob that from a guy and say, hey, I'm a radio guy. Can I ask you some questions? Because you know what he would have said? Call my office. So I didn't bug him. And today, Dom, I had the appointed walkthrough, and I went and interviewed Mark Pocan. But here's what I didn't account for. They had shut down the entire Capitol Hill complex, and I'm carrying around this gear case, this 60-ish pound gear case. I mean, this gear case weighs more than Lauren Boebert, dude. This gear case is heavy. And I'm thinking, I'm a strapping dude. I had plenty of energy all the way up to the Capitol. I mean, I'm carrying this 60-pounder. I'm trading arms, but I'm doing it. You know, I'm doing it. And then I waited for the press conference that never came. Eventually it came, but it came without Crute because I had moved on to the Longworth building, my interview with Mark Pocan, and then I got to walk back. And they will not let me back on the Capitol grounds.
You got to go around?
I had to go around the entire Capitol grounds. And although Madison, Wisconsin built a little bit on the basics of Washington, D.C., the Capitol grounds here are substantially larger than the Wisconsin Capitol grounds. Down many, many fine monuments on the grounds. I found myself looking at a monument to General Grant, and I thought, this is a good step to set the gear down because on the way back, it was like a 3-mile walk with 60 pounds of gear. And I'm now wearing shorts and fortunately in the air-conditioned Royal Sonesta where Bill Press, our D.C. buddy, podcaster, prognosticator, pundit, and friend of the Devil's Advocates, Bill Press, joining me here, 6:30 D.C. time, 5:30 Central time. So can't wait for Bill. He's joining me at the Royal Sonesta. And I sent you a picture of the pillow on the bed when I got here. And there's this matching. I'll put it up on our Facebook. If you haven't seen the Devil's Advocates Facebook, I've even gone live a couple times today for you. And the art in the lobby here, an enormous beaver face, and he's wearing a crown, and this is not like some print. This is a portrait they had done, and in the room that I'm staying in, there was also a finely embroidered cushion on the bed, and it also is a beaver, and I sent you a picture of the stuffed cushion, and you said, nice beaver, and I said, I just had it stuffed.
Naked Gun, well done, sir.
So anyways, buddy, my wife, obviously not cognizant of the fact that I'm doing a show right now. But, Dom, we are in D.C. Me and Mrs. Crute, she not paying attention to the clock, nor I, but having a good time. And we brought you back as Speaker of the House. I understand someone's got sound of that.
I believe we do have some sound. Nate doing the hard work today. We got some Jeffries and... we have some Johnson. Let's start with the man of the hour. Johnson? Mike Johnson? Is that his name? We have some reporting on him. CNN has a piece, of course, Washington Post. We have some things will, you know, let you know about Mike Johnson. But let's hear the new speaker, Nate, cut number 7, please.
Kevin has dedicated over 2 decades of his life to selfless public service, 16 of those years in this House. And you would be hard-pressed to find anybody who loves this institution more or has contributed more to it. He is the reason we're in this majority today.
Selfless, so selfless. Let's keep going. The new speaker, Johnson. America, we hear you. I somehow doubt it. Cut 8.
I want to say to the American people, on behalf of all of us here, we hear you. We know the challenges you're facing. We know that that there's a lot going on in our country, domestically and abroad, and we are ready to get to work again to solve those problems, and we will.
I'll believe it when I see it, Mr. Johnson. Here we go. He's very gaudy. Let's hear what he had to say. Cut 9.
I believe that each one of us has a huge responsibility today to use the gifts that God has given us to serve the extraordinary people of this great country, and they deserve it, and to ensure that our republic remains standing as the great beacon of light and hope and freedom in a world that desperately needs it.
Yeah, but not too bright, because, you know, that southern border, we don't have too many people coming here. Cut number 10, please.
We have a catastrophe at our southern border. The Senate and the White House can no longer ignore the problem. From Texas to New York, wave after wave of illegal migrants are stressing our communities to their breaking points. We know that our streets are being flooded with fentanyl, and all of our communities, children, and even adults are dying from it. The status quo is unacceptable. Inaction is unacceptable, and we must come together and address the broken border. We have to do it.
Let's hear the 7 tenets that make America, according to the new speaker, Mike Johnson.
I call them the 7 core principles of American conservatism, but let me concede to you all, I think it's really quintessentially the core principles of our nation. I boil them down to individual freedom, limited government, the rule of law, peace through strength, fiscal responsibility, free markets, and human dignity. Those are the foundations that made us the extraordinary nation that we are. And you and I today are the stewards of those principles. The things that have made us the freest, most powerful, most successful nation in the history of the world. The things that have made us truly exceptional.
Rule of law and fiscal responsibility? This is the mega. They call him Mega Mike Johnson. I think Gates called him that. And this was a guy who helped lead the effort to overturn the election. Yeah, he's really all about the rule of law. If you would apply that law to your own president, sir, maybe he would not have supported you in this effort.
Dom, I knew a kid in 1981 named Blaine that had this guy's haircut. That is a throwback. That is a feathered throwback haircut. Devil's Advocates, Crute, Does DC, Wednesday edition. Come on back with us. My exclusive interview with Mark Pocan at 4:30 and Bill Press at the Royal Sedesta, Capitol Hill at 5:30. More Devils.
When they go low, we get high. The Devil's Advocates.
And we are back from the 420 break. Thank you for listening to the Devil's Advocates radio show. You can always join this fine show. Phone lines are open at 844-967-2789. Make sure you stick around. Crute's exclusive interview with Congressman Mark Pocan coming up at the bottom of the hour.
I got Mark immediately after he came off the House Speaker vote. And, Tom, I got to tell you, I was a little shocked. The Republican caucus just 3 weeks and a day later have elected their fourth choice on the first ballot. Yeah, I
mean. Wow.
Is this a sign of progress? You know, I'm going to preview the interview with Mark Pocan. I said, you know, now that we've got a speaker, is this about governance or shutting down the government?
Yes, exactly.
He'll tell you.
He'll tell you.
Coming up very soon.
We have a couple more cuts from the new speaker, Mike Johnson. Let's get to that. Of course, then Minority Leader Hakeem Jeffries also spoke.
He was
today.
Killing it.
Yeah, he's so good. Here is Johnson. Just a couple more. The House back for business, baby. If the House is a rockin', don't come a knockin'. Cut 12, please.
And we want our allies around the world to know that this body of lawmakers is reporting again to our duty stations. Let the enemies of freedom around the world hear us loud and clear. The People's House is back in business.
All right. Yeah, but, you know, I want you to do me a favor, though. You know, we'll do some business with you. You do some business with me. Just do me a little favor, will you? You know, that kind of business, the Trump business, Mega Mike Johnson. Just curious. Last one from the new speaker, the reason he is the speaker. Cut number 13, please.
I don't believe there are any coincidences in a matter like this. I believe that scripture, the Bible, is very clear.
Oh, God.
That God is the one that raises up those in authority. He raised up each of you, all of us.
So if God raises them up, then did God strike them down? I mean, is Kevin McCarthy down because of Matt Gaetz or because of God? Or does that mean Matt Gaetz is God? I'm just so confused. Hakeem Jeffries also spoke today. Let's hear what he had to say. Cut number one, please.
From the very beginning of this Congress, House Democrats have made clear that we will find bipartisan common ground with our Republican colleagues whenever and wherever possible for the good of the American people. And House Democrats have repeatedly done just that.
I mean, it was a bipartisan vote to remove McCarthy. He can't really go against that, right? He went with the other eight. And don't let McCarthy, he'll tell you, he'll remind you all the time, you know, these crazy eight and every single Dem. But I digress. Speaker Hakeem Jeffries, cut number two, please.
It was House Democrats who provided a majority of the votes necessary to avoid a catastrophic default on our debt that would have crashed the U.S. economy and triggered a job-killing recession. It was House Democrats who provided a majority of the votes necessary to avoid a government shutdown that would have hurt everyday Americans. It was House Democrats who provided a majority of the votes necessary to secure $16 billion in disaster assistance for Americans whose lives have been devastated by extreme weather events. From the very beginning of this Congress, House Democrats have been governing for the people.
Oh, yeah. Love me some Hakeem Jeffries, man. Time for partisanship is over. Cut three.
The time for gamesmanship is over. The time for brinksmanship is over. The time for partisanship is over. It's time to get back to doing the business of the American people.
Time to get back to work, Crute. Just two more from Hakeem Jeffries. The union must succeed. Cut four.
And we have but one charge to keep during this moment of great fragility. Our union must be sustained. Our union must be strengthened. Our union must succeed.
That's very interesting considering who they just elected to be Speaker of the House. The final cut from Hakeem Jeffries. Cut five, please.
We faced adversity right here in the House of Representatives when on January 6, 2021, a violent mob of insurrectionists incited by some in this chamber overran the House floor as part of an effort to halt the peaceful transfer of power. Every time we faced adversity, the good news here in America is that we always overcome.
Hakeem Jeffries.
Damn.
Yes, lighting
just
it
sticking
up.
It to them to their faces,
well,
Don.
Absolutely.
Because those
that's
insurrectionists supporting Congress people, they're in that room at that time. Nobody left yet. He's speaking to the entire House. Except for Derek Van Orden.
Yeah, exactly. Just a little bit from the Washington Post. Johnson, 51, opposed certifying the results of the 2020 election. Here's what he tweeted out on, this is November 7th of 2020. Quote, "I just called President Trump to say this. Stay strong and keep fighting, sir. The nation is depending upon your resolve. We must exhaust every available legal remedy to restore America's trust in the fairness of our election system." Johnson also objected to certifying Biden's electoral win and was one of the architects of a legal attack on the election that consisted of arguing the state's voting accommodations during the pandemic were unconstitutional. He led a group of 126 Republican lawmakers in filing an amicus brief to the Supreme Court challenging the authorities in Georgia, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan had usurped the constitutional authority of state legislatures when they loosened voting restrictions because of the pandemic. The court rejected the underlying complaint filed by the state of Texas, citing a lack of standing, and dismissed all other related motions, including the amicus brief. But according to the new Speaker of the House, Mike Johnson, us in Wisconsin, by engaging and trying to help people to go vote during a pandemic, well, that was our attempt to usurp the constitutional authority, and therefore, we should overturn the election. That, among many other criticisms that I have, the guy's super anti-LGBTQ. The guy's also obviously very, very anti-abortion. So, I mean, he's Mega Mike, man. So congratulations. They got what they wanted.
Dom, my understanding, and I did see press questioning some of the Republicans as they came off the Hill. What do you think about a speaker that would support a complete abortion ban on a federal level? Because it is my understanding that's this guy. And the Don't Say Gay bill on the federal level, that is also this guy. So this Mike Johnson character, he's a little unsavory to a lot of the things that we as progressives, you and I perhaps, Dom, I guess I'm just speaking for myself here, but I find this guy to be here's how I heard him analogized. He's been here a long time, long enough to make friends, but not long enough to make the entrenched enemies that a few of the prior candidates, see Jim Jordan, Steve Scalise, had. Give him a little time, Dom. I think he's an equal opportunity offender. I think he's going to have lots of enemies here, at least on Capitol Hill. My good friend, Mark Pocan, at least my good congressman, he allowed me to interview him immediately after coming off the floor. He showed me into his chambers. And Dom, it's a dog-friendly place. While we're doing the interview, beautiful golden lab of one of his staffers hanging out, wagging her tail, because Mark keeps dog treats right in his office. They all know. All the dogs know.
Yeah, for sure, man. That's great.
So come on back. This is a pre-recorded interview, but this one's only about 90 minutes old, still fresh off the presses. My exclusive sound with Mark Pocan addressing the election of a speaker. Devil's Advocates, Crute does D.C., and Mark Pocan, my good congressman, friend of the Devil's Advocates. My exclusive interview with him, pre-recorded, is next. Welcome back to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show. Crute does DC, and I am here in the office of Mark Pocan. And Mark, we have a Speaker of the House. What can you tell me about Rep. Mike Johnson?
Really as fresh as possible, right? I literally walked back in the last 20 minutes or so. Well, I can tell you he's definitely going to fit the mainstream of MAGA America. He's a guy who was one of the people who helped orchestrate the election denial of 2020. He's a guy who is virulently anti-gay. He actually introduced the Don't Say Gay bill at the federal level that we've seen in some states. Even before he was in Congress, he was representing extremist anti-equality groups. On choice, I believe one of the members told me on the floor that his position on abortion is that you should have to actually serve time for doing it, or point he said that. So this is a MAGA extremist that's now going to be the speaker. Kevin McCarthy governed like a MAGA extremist, just Kevin never stood for anything. So, you know, he was like flavorless jello and just whatever was next to him, he kind of resembled. But this guy resembles an extremist. He's a Christian nationalist. So, you know, Marjorie Taylor Greene is a white Christian nationalist. This guy happens to be white. So I think you get the idea. They're very, very similar. I think as the media start digging into his background, since he was so fresh, this all happened in 24 hours, I think you're going to see a lot of things. They're going to be a little bit spooky come Halloween.
Yeah, some of your Republican colleagues were returning from Capitol Hill, crossing the street over here to the Longworth building. I saw there were reporters questioning, do you support, because they all voted for this guy, right, Mark? Yeah. Do you support a guy who supports a complete abortion ban?
Yeah.
And I had not yet heard that about Johnson, but this guy is so fresh. I haven't done any digging on this guy. I can't even tell you. I had seen him before. I had that haircut in 1989, I swear to God, when I had hair, Mark. But complete abortion ban, that is about as extreme as it gets.
Yeah, and in this organization that he defended before he was in Congress, this anti-gay group, supposedly another member told me that their stated purpose is to go back to like third century Christian law, pre-printing press. Like, this is a group that he's defending and affiliated with. So I think, you know, people are going to find out a lot in the next week about him. And you could just tell from his speech, he kept having all kinds of biblical references. At least, you know, he's not faking it, right? I guess we'll know where he's at, and I'll give him that.
He has faith. He's a true believer. Actually, he is my congressman, Mark Pocan. I am in his office here on the Longworth building, Capitol Hill. Mark, I appreciate you accommodating me so shortly after the vote. I never would have imagined they'd have pulled off Plan D in one vote. I thought there'd be opposition. What parts of his soul do you think he had to give up to win in the first ballot?
You know, I think since this is the third week of this circus that's been in town, and you know, the clown car was a little crowded, and I think they finally decided they just had to do this. We had to start governing again. I mean, the resolution we're going to vote on a little bit later to stand with Israel made sense 16 days ago. Right now, honestly, it doesn't, but we'll still do it. But we've been just MIA as a Congress. Not as MIA as Derek Van Orden, because he's literally not even in the country during this vote. And what's so ironic is he's in Israel supposedly using on a fact-finding tour that only he can do, and he'll miss a resolution to support Israel in Congress. But, you know, that's the irony of Derek Van Orden. But, you know, this is something I think they realized that had they not done something, they were beyond ridiculous, right? I mean, they'd been lampooned, they'd been caricatured, everything, and they just had to do something. This guy just happened to be the guy as the chairs were being pulled away with the music, had a chair sitting, and that's who their next speaker is.
Folks, that's Mark Pocan. He is the congressman from Wisconsin's 2nd CD. We've got a new Speaker of the House. I was looking for, a white plume of smoke off of Capitol Hill, something of the sort. Mike Johnson kind of came out of nowhere. I can't tell you a lot about him, Congressman. What experiences do you have? Any personal experience? Have you ever tried to work across the aisle with this guy?
At least I knew his name. Some of the people putting their names forward, I never even heard of before. I'm like, who's that? What's this member? But in his case, you know, he's been just known as, I think, the Republican study group he did work with. He might have been leading that. So kind of like a caucus like we have on the Democratic side. And but he's not really, you know, stood out for much of anything, right? I mean, other than we knew that he was probably one of the leading anti-gay folks in Congress, putting in the Don't Say Gay bill at the federal level. So being the chair of the Equality Caucus, he was on my radar screen in that regard. But if you asked me, Well, I know he has five kids because he just said that. I know he's married because he said that. Like, I know nothing else about the guy. What we're learning is all at the same time about him, literally, as a member.
And Mark, someone that would challenge your very existence as a gay man who's married to a husband, is there a common ground? How do you find a common ground with someone that doesn't want you to exist, at least in your current form, in your current marriage? What would you say to a guy like that?
Well, and that's what we're going to have to figure out. I mean, when Angie Craig from Minnesota voted for Hakeem Jeffries, she said, it's my wife and I's anniversary, and all the Dems applauded and stood up, and Republicans just sat there silent. Now, even that usually is the comedy that you would have of, you know, okay, fine, it's your anniversary, we'll applaud. But they can't even do that under this new extreme. So I think you're going to see is a very religious right turn. They always were, you know, kind of extreme, the MAGA, obviously, side, but it's going to be even more along those issues. Like at one point when he said, when he looked at Moses, and I kind of looked up because he was talking about being in the chamber, I thought maybe he was referring to a picture. I think he was seeing things, literally, as he's describing that moment. And that's a little scary, right? I'd be glad to talk to him about these issues, but knowing that he's speaker, this is probably where his priorities are going to fall, and we're probably going to see more of this discriminatory legislation come before the House of Representatives.
You're listening to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show, Crute in D.C. I'm in the office of Congressman Mark Pocan, my congressman, our friend. Mark, I appreciate you accommodating. Let's talk about the important business of keeping the country running.
Yeah.
We've got a deadline coming November 17th, I believe, Congressman,
yes.
And the country runs out of money. So does the election of a speaker, at least it's a step, the Republican caucus has finally taken a step. Is this a step towards keeping the government open or towards another government shutdown?
It sounds like everyone understands, because we haven't worked for the last several weeks, and this was the clock ticking on that date. We need one more continuing resolution, likely to mid-January is what I'm hearing. I think that's the most likely date. And we'll probably get appropriation bills. The next 2 weeks, I was supposed to be back home. I'll be here instead. So again, I got to blow up my calendar and everyone that we were supposed to get around and see in the district. I won't, because I'll be here. But if we get all the appropriation bills done in the House, or as many as they can get done, at least that gives them a little better negotiating position. But generally, when you go to conference with the Senate, for the House and the Senate to figure out the appropriations process, it's a 40 to 50 day process. So that would give us enough time to go to mid-January to get it done, even with the holidays. And I think that's realistic. So I don't think there'll be a big push to not have a continuing resolution. I do think the next few weeks will be this, what I call fantasy Congress, because these bills they're marking up are never going to become law in the House side.
What's this honeymoon going to look like, Mark?
It's going to be interesting. Well, that's the thing is, you know, as soon as he does something responsible,
yeah,
there are certain people in his caucus who are not going to be happy. So, you know, I just thought Mike Gallagher, believe it or not, from Wisconsin, for a while, his name popped up because he didn't fit the most extreme categories in a few areas, but he's also way too smart to want this job right now, because it's a tough job with this kind of extreme Republican caucus. So we'll see how he succeeds.
Mark Pocan, I was doing a walking trip around D.C. I'm in D.C. for a couple of days, and I was in Union Station today, mm-hmm. and sort of an impromptu pro-Palestinian people, mm-hmm. Protests going on. Lots of fake blood, lots of bodies, lots of small babies on the floor. And Mark, I know you've been supportive of the Palestinian people. This is a nuanced topic, and we haven't waited a lot in foreign policy, and I don't want to, Mark.
Yeah.
But how do you balance support for the Israelis and their right to defend themselves with support for the Palestinians that are living in the Gaza amongst Hamas? How do you manage this fine balance, Congressman?
And it's tricky. And honestly, I get yelled at by everyone, so I think maybe I'm doing the right thing. That my position has been, one, it was a horrific attack, right? You can't paraglide in and kill people. What Hamas did was brutal and deserves to have the response from Israel to Hamas. The problem is it's become collective punishment of everyone in Gaza. That's 2.2 million people. That is wrong. So, what we've been trying to have a position of saying, look, there should be a cessation of hostilities towards civilians. I mean, this is becoming collective punishment, and the push that hurts 2.2 million people, not the at most maybe 30,000 people that are supposedly in Hamas, but certainly we know 1,000 people that were part of that attack. So it has to be more strategic what they're doing. but not this wholesale punishment. I mean, not having any food and water and fuels. Right now, the hospitals are out of fuels. That means ventilators for premature babies can't work. That means they don't have medications. So I noticed a very pro-Israeli group, although I'd really say more pro-Netanyahu group in the U.S. just put out, you know, showing babies born in Israel saying under the rocket fire from Gaza. Well, one, we have Iron Dome to take out those rockets, so they have, you know, a safer existence because of it. But that's not true in Gaza. And the same babies, doesn't matter where the baby is, we should be concerned about babies that are at risk. And I think we have to have a position that says, stop the cessation of hostilities against civilians. Because I think that is happening, moving half of the population. I mean, clearly that's not going after the goal, but respecting the right that Israel has a right to respond to Hamas for the attack. It's a tough position. Some people want to talk about the 20 years of inequities with how people in Gaza were treated. I completely agree, but now's not that debate necessarily. And others want to say, no, what happened is if you live in Gaza, too bad. Hamas is the governing body, therefore you're going to pay a price. I also don't agree with that. So I'm getting it a little bit from everyone, which I think I'm pretty comfortable with, since I am kind of one of the people that spends the most time talking about Gaza in Congress. I've been trying to get in for 5 or 6 years. I had just gotten permission from the Israeli government to go, and this happened, so I'm sure I'm not going to be able to go right now. But it's been a pretty awful situation. I mean, the conditions there have been just enough to survive, which is awful. It's really an open-air prison, and now you throw in what's going on and people can't leave. I mean, that's not acceptable. We need a much better humanitarian response out of Israel than they're doing, and I think they're hurting their case right now by doing this, what I think appears to be indiscriminate bombing.
Mark Pocan, my congressman, I know we're short on time because I've been peeking at your phone. Mark, let me ask you, I'm a little concerned about escalation and the United States getting pulled more broadly into this centuries, thousands, millennia-old conflict in the Middle East. And as a guy who served after the first or during the first Iraq War, you know, anything that happens in the Middle East concerns me that we as a country are going to escalate. Mark, are there any valid fears there?
If Hezbollah or Iran gets in directly, that would be a problem. So I think, you know, that's part of why I think the strategy, what Israel's doing in Gaza, is more likely to draw them in, because it does appear that they're punishing 2.2 million people who are not Hamas. And as long as that happens, we're at risk. And so, you know, one, I think it's in Israel's best interest to have a smarter policy than they're currently having in responding in Gaza. But if either of those countries got in, it certainly would be an elevated situation. And you could see, you know, the U.S. looking at different ways of responding. Right now, there is a security package that just got introduced that has a lot of money for both security for Israel, as well as humanitarian aid for Gaza. So we'll see how that proceeds in this brand new Congress with a brand new speaker. There's a lot that Congress and certainly the administration need to do to make sure that we don't get pulled into this.
Mark Pocan, any final thoughts for your constituents back in Wisconsin here as I wrap things up with you?
Just, you know, pay attention to stuff and reach out to us. People certainly have, especially around Israel and Gaza, and that's good. We need to hear from people. But, you know, be active and contact your two senators. There's going to be a lot flying, especially with that November 17th date coming up and having to get this budget package done. The decisions that we do here impact people's lives. And honestly, last week, many of the groups that were focused on trying to stop the bombing, rightfully so, in Gaza, completely missed a security supplemental that was the funding for the next year for all humanitarian aid on the planet and from the U.S. And it's a number that I think is lower than I'm happy with. But the groups missed it because they were busy looking at something else. And I need people to really follow everything closely, reach out to us and to your senators and be heard.
Mark Pocan, thank you so much for letting me join you here at the office. I hear the bell.
Yeah.
Saved by the bell, Mark.
No, that's, I don't know. They've got another vote. We're going to be on the floor soon, but I also have a meeting in Hakeem Jeffries' office, our leader. The top 10, like, caucuses meet with him weekly, and so I'm part of that as chair of the Equality Caucus. So I'll learn probably a lot in the next hour.
Well, excellent, Mark Pocan. Thank you so much for joining me back soon. Crute in D.C., more Devil's Advocates. We'll be right back.
big and tall of political talk. The Devil's Advocates. All I want for
a rambling man. And we are back. Thank you for listening to the Devil's Advocates radio show. Phone lines are open. You can join us on the lines at 844-967-2789.
Dominic, want to thank my most recent guest, recorded a couple hours ago with Mark Pocan, my congressman, our friend. How'd I do, fella?
Oh, well done, Crute. Nice job. Nice to hear Pocan as well.
And as mentioned, that is a super cool office, dog friendly.
Yeah, I love that.
He is in the Longworth building and apparently must share at least a building with Lauren Boebert. I saw her over there. Saw Gwen Moore today as well. Nice to see your congresswoman, Gwen Moore. She sends her regards, Dom.
Well, excellent. We plan on having Gwen, I believe, next month she'll be joining us.
Well, she said she had a doctor's appointment tomorrow where we would have made some plans for sooner than that. But, Dom, we got a fine D.C. pundit, podcaster, and friend of the Devil's Advocates, Bill Press, to join me here in the lobby at the Royal Sonesta, Capitol Hill. Dom, I think I picked the right week to be.
It was very fortuitous, Curdy. Mike Johnson, I mean, I've been, during the interview, listening to you and Mark, kind of perusing the headlines and finding out a little bit more about this. And we'll get to your calls in just a moment, 844-967-2789, Wall Street Journal reporting. While Mike Johnson served as head of the Republican Study Commission, which represents a spectrum of House conservatives, Johnson presided over a budget blueprint designed to balance the federal budget in 10 years. Among other things, it pushed the idea long associated with former House Speaker Paul Ryan of Wisconsin to turn Medicare into a premium support system in which beneficiaries would receive financial assistance to buy health insurance through a regulated Medicare exchange. The plan also proposed raising the retirement age to 69 for people born in 1960 and later. The current requirement is 67. So he's one of those guys, Crute. And also, CNN reporting this as well, something Johnson, in the mid-2000s, his anti-gay rhetoric was harsh. Quote, homosexual relationships are inherently unnatural, and the studies clearly show are ultimately harmful and costly for everyone. Society cannot give its stamp of approval to such a dangerous lifestyle. If we change marriage for this tiny, modern minority, we'll have to do it for every deviant group. Polygamists, polyamorists, pedophiles, and others will be next in line to claim equal protection. They already are. There will be no legal basis to deny a bisexual the right to marry a partner of each sex or a person to marry his pet. Can we marry dogs? Wasn't that a clayfish thing? Granted, this was back in mid-2000s. This is, you know, perhaps almost 20 years ago. Perhaps now Speaker Mike Johnson has evolved on these issues, but I kind of doubt it. So that's what we're dealing with. And, I feel like a guy like Mark, I mean, Mark's gay, Mark's married. You know what I'm saying? If it were up to Speaker Johnson, your congressman, our friend Mark Pocan, it would be illegal for him to marry his gay partner? I mean, this is what we're dealing with. This is the mega of the mega. Bipartisanship, good luck with that, Hakeem Jeffries, although I appreciate the effort.
Well, Dom, that's why we love Congressman Mark Pocan, because I know if that guy was talking about your marriage or my marriage, it'd be F that guy, right?
No doubt, man. Absolutely. He's way better in that job, perhaps, than I would be. 844-967-2789. We've got some callers holding. Let's get to them while we have some time. Dave from Madison, you are up. Welcome, Dave. What do you got for us?
Hey, Dave.
Yeah, I like Mark. Yeah, he's a great representative. I disagree with him on the couple few things he said about Gaza. The main thing was Israel is not deliberately punishing the civilian population there. I mean, the modus operandi of Hamas is to locate around, mosques, hospitals, et cetera, civilian areas in order to garner as much sympathy as they can for their cause if Israel has to conduct any kind of a bombing campaign. Now, people see, buildings you know, civilian buildings fall. You know, those confuse people because they're civilian buildings, but they become a military target when they're used, say, to fire artillery rockets in Israel. You know, a lot of this, if not all of it, is suppression of the rocket artillery that's continuing to fall on the Israeli civilian population. I mean, there's no country in the world that wouldn't fight back against rocket artillery.
Dave, yes, that's a great point. Unfortunately, the population density of Gaza is like the thickest in the world, and there's obviously going to be civilian casualties. It's a tough line to hold, certainly. Dick from the garage, you're next. Welcome, Dick. What do you got for us?
Well, hey, Dick. I'm watching this guy. Yeah, hey, guys. Here's what scares me about him. He seems likable. He did some even self-deprecating humor, and most people don't follow this. I told Matt earlier, like you guys, and every 4 years they tout somebody out for president. But so now we got this new fascist speaker, and he reminds me, I told Matt earlier, of this kid I grew up with, and my friend's dad called him a shrewdie, and he was kind of like the Eddie Haskell character.
Yeah, right.
But yeah, and he flew under the radar. But what's even worse, did you hear what Kinzinger said about him already?
What's that?
This is funny. He is Jim Jordan in drag.
Wow. I'm not clear where that one comes from, but thanks for the call, Mark. I'm sorry, that was Dick. Mark, you'll have the last minute. What do you got for us?
Yeah,
hey, Mark.
Thanks for taking my call. Hey guys. And apologies to Bill from Oconomowoc, confusing him with Bill from Grantsburg the other day. But the Bill from Oconomowoc has a lot more sense than that. But it's just ridiculous that this guy is talking this religious line, and it just offends me that he ignores the whole no religious test in this country. We do not need to have our country ruled by third century Christian law or any third century religious law, period. That we are a secular country, and we should remain so. And this guy should be reminded that Louisiana does not have religious tests in their constitution, as the United States Constitution does not have. So get over this whole religious test crap, Mr. Johnson.
I'm with you, Mark. Amen, brother.
More Devil's Advocates. Crute does DC. And I got a fine friend joining me here at the Royal Sonesta Capitol Hill. He's Bill Prest. Bill Press, no T. He's a podcaster. He's a pundit. He's a friend of ours. Bill
it's
Press.
It's not sour. It's not sweet. It's Bill Press.
It's just right. More Devil's Advocates. The happier, happy hour. Rolling live from D.C.
WMDX. Did you know this local radio station is part of Civic Media? Learn more about the entire network at civicmedia.us.
Hey, Dom, how many palindromes can you name in 30 seconds?
Race car, mom, dad, reefer, refer, kayak, level. Did I say mom already?
You're forgetting one really important one.
Zero res.
Not only is it the coolest palindrome ever, it's also our favorite.
Right, I remember. Why is that again?
They advertise with us.
Zero res, my favorite palindrome.
And carpet cleaner. Get the best carpet cleaning ever. Schedule your carpet cleaning online at zeroresmedicine.com. Tell them the Devil's Advocate sent you.
You're listening to Mad Radio, WMDX 1580 AM Columbus, W224 EG Madison, and always streaming on the Civic Media app.
ABC News, I'm Michelle Franzen. The House is expected to reconvene this evening after Republicans elected Speaker Mike Johnson. It follows 3 weeks of turmoil with Republicans divided over the leadership role. Johnson said his first bill will focus on the needs of Israel.
In this time of great crisis,
It is our duty to work together, as previous generations of great leaders have, to face these great challenges and solve these great problems.
The White House says President Biden spoke to Johnson by phone to congratulate him. President Biden also met with Australia's prime minister today. Both leaders expressed support for Israel, but also urged Israel to prioritize getting hostages released and avoid civilian casualties in Gaza as it destroys Hamas holdouts. The strongest hurricane on record to hit Mexico's Pacific coastline is wreaking havoc near Acapulco. Hurricane Otis made landfall as a Category 5 storm overnight. Mexico's president says a death toll still unclear, but roads and structures have been hit hard by the storm. Michelle Franz in ABC News.
For Civic Media News, I'm Terry Bell. Here's what Wisconsin needs to know. Part of Interstate 90 in Wisconsin might be named after the state's Native American code talkers. There's a bill in the legislature to dedicate the stretch of freeway between La Crosse and Toma, the Ho-Chunk World War II Code Talkers Memorial Highway. Code talkers used their tribal languages for secret communication to help the U.S. Army win World Wars I and II. The state of Wisconsin is joining a federal lawsuit against the social media company Meta. 32 other states are part of the suit. It accuses Meta of knowingly designing and launching addictive features on Instagram and Facebook, leading to a mental health crisis for young people across the nation. The coalition also says it's looking into the social media app TikTok for similar reasons. I'm Terry Bell, Civic Media News. Now, here's what you need to know closer to home.
For WMDX News, I'm Nate Wenkehout. The Madison School District will soon change the start and dismissal times for many schools. That's after several problems with the district's new bus provider, First Student. Several parents tell Channel 3 that their kids were left waiting as long as an hour for their bus. School board member Nikki Vandermeulen complains that school district administrators didn't get the school board's approval before making the changes. Madison City Council member Regina Vitiver says she's running for Dane County Executive. Joe Parisi is retiring next year. Vitiver represents Madison's Near West Side on the City Council. Vitiver says she wants to increase access to behavioral health care, affordable housing, and to fight climate change. Verona Mayor Luke Diaz and Dane County Supervisor Annalise Eicher may also get into the race. The election for County Executive will happen next November alongside the presidential election. And that's what you need to know. I'm Nate Wuggehout, WMDX News.
Radio keeps your community informed, entertained, and connected. It's what we're all about at the Civic Media Network of local radio stations.
We're having fun and moving fast to preserve hometown radio across Wisconsin. This includes a commitment.
There we go. I'm going to end this segment with some Clapton.
All right, on thank you, man.
Running on Faith.
Which one is it?
Running on Faith.
Oh, I don't know if I know that one. All right. Across the state about it. A little slow, man.
Yeah, it's a little slow. Maybe I'll find something else. What were the other ones that you...
No Alibis or Pretending or Bad Love. I think they're all off of the Crossroads album. Josh Myers, Luke Musgrave, Darnell Savage,
and Eric Stokes did not practice. I'll get one of them. All right, something a little bit more
upbeat. A little more upbeat. Yeah, right, man.
LaFleur says Jones is still sore from Sunday's game. Defensive back Eric Stokes, after missing the past year with a foot and knee injury, is back in IR with a hamstring, and safety Darnell Savage has been moved to the injured reserve after re-aggravating a calf muscle. Backup Jonathan Owens is expected to start at safety Sunday against the Vikings.
Cody just texted me, said Bill Press is in a car heading this way, so I don't know. It doesn't mean anything, but I assume he's going to be coming in hot.
Cool. Okay.
Baseball Craig Counsell is headed to New York for a job interview. The Brewers granting permission to allow the New York Mets to interview Counsell to become their next manager. With sports, I'm Mike Clemens.
Here's your Mad Radio forecast. Lows dip down to about 61 tonight under cloudy skies with scattered thunderstorms likely. Southerly winds 5 to 10 miles an hour. Scattered thunderstorms again tomorrow. Highs around 67. For Civic Media, I'm meteorologist Derek Height. Currently, it's 62 degrees.
Saturdays and Sundays at 1, don't miss Under the Helmet with the Gravedigger, featuring legendary Gilbert Brown and Earl Ingram. Football, life, and fun.
Earl, you've been driving a UK.
Ferraris with turbo boost. So enjoy it, brother.
Under the Helmet with the Gravedigger. Gilbert Brown and Earl Ingram. Saturdays and Sundays at 1 on the Civic Media Network and on the Civic Media app. You can always continue the conversation on social media. Share your thoughts when you find and follow Civic Media on Facebook, X, and
warning, you are about to listen to the greatest radio show ever. And due to contractual obligations and to shield our airwaves and corporate licensees from any semblance of liability, responsibility, and gullibility, we must tell you the views represented on this show are not necessarily those of this station or its management. This radio show contains differing points of view on current political topics, and due to the nature of its contents, it should be heard by everyone. Thank you for listening. 3, 2, 1. Now live from the Devil Radio Studios in Madison, Wisconsin, where the political party is just beginning. Welcome to the Devil's Advocate Show. Friends proving it's never personal, only politics.
Please allow me to introduce myself.
Here is your host, Mike Crute.
Welcome back to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show. Crudy Does DC, Wednesday edition, happier, happy hour. Dom, I see you at Madison in the Solidarity Realty Studios. I see Nate in the booth. And you fine folks, you can always be a part, 844-967-2789. And my pal Bill Press joining me here at the Royal Sonesta Capitol Hill in D.C. Dom, I came to D.C. I brought you back a Speaker of the House.
But it's not,
not a good speaker.
No, but a speaker.
But a speaker.
A speaker. At least we can get some business done, question mark. Like, what kind of business? I don't know. Anti-LGBTQ. I got to say this. I quoted the new Speaker Johnson from mid-2000s when he was very, very critical about gay marriage. Further in the, also in this CNN article, Johnson, according to Punch a Bowl News, reportedly made an issue of Tom Emmer's vote. Now, Tom Emmer, of course, he initially beat out Johnson, came under fire from conservatives for voting to codify same-sex marriage in 2022. I said, I mentioned maybe Johnson maybe changed his tune on this. No, no, he hasn't. He's super anti-gay man. He's Mega Mike.
Now, when Emmer voted for Johnson, Mike Johnson, that is, the whole chamber, well, at least the Republican caucus, got up and cheered a standing O for Emmer for quote-unquote doing the right thing.
I mean, I guess that's pretty much representative of the Republican stance these days, anti-LGBTQ. And given how white Christian nationally he is, I'm not surprised. Now, how that flows from the speakership and how that affects, you know, the business of governing, we'll have to wait and see. But, you know my thoughts on the whole topic, Scrutiny.
Well, Dominic, the other big story of the day, at least as far as I was concerned, Donald Trump took the stand today in his own fraud trial, at least on a limited capacity, and apparently he was questioned, why should the judge not impose further sanctions because he continues to break the gag order? My understanding, and he stood before the judge, and he gave testimony. In my understanding, this was before Michael Cohen, the former fixer, was brought into the courtroom, Tom. And Cohen was not able to comment on it. Cohen did a little presser. I did observe some of that as I was scrambling back from the hill. But here's the point. The judge in this trial said Trump was not credible and fined him another $10,000 and said the next time it's going to be worse, whatever worse means, Dom.
According to the Raw story, calling Trump to the stand, the judge asked Trump if he made comments this morning, quoted in the Associated Press, that were considered to be attacking a court clerk. Trump replied that he did and Engeron ruled it was a violation, according to MSNBC's Lisa Rubin. Quote, as you can see, and everyone can see, first of all, my principal law clerk is very close to me, the judge explained while Trump was on the stand. You and I can see each other. We're close. And there's a barrier between us. Would that be at best somewhat ambiguous? Don't you always refer to Michael Cohen as Michael Cohen? The judge continued, responding to a claim earlier made in the day that Trump's lawyer, Chris Kizzy, said the comment had been directed at Cohen. No, Trump claimed. Maybe worse, the attorney chimed in. Maybe a lot worse, another Trump attorney, Alina Haba, quipped. Engeron excused Trump from the stand and said, as the trier of fact, I find the witness was not credible. He was referring to my law clerk, who was much closer to me. He hit Trump with another 10K. Oh, he's not messing around.
Not credible, Dom.
I hope he takes cash from Trump, because I'm not sure that check would cash.
844-967-2789. Now, I don't know if you heard any of the reporting on the testimony, because this is not a televised trial, this fraud trial, and this does not lead to jail time for Trump, not directly at least, but it is very damning to his reputation as this successful businessman. And I know yesterday I was watching some of the post-Cohen testimony reporting. He was on the stand yesterday and again today, Dom. And my understanding is Cohen has been to some degree undermined by Alina Haba, the attorney for Trump, in that he did admit on the stand he had lied in prior federal proceedings before the judge. So, you know, why are you telling the truth now? Well, part of the testimony Cohen made is that Trump consistently told him and the, what, CFO Alan Weisselberg, I'm worth perhaps one day $4.5 million on paper. No, billion that is. Trump's always bees. No, I'm worth $6 billion. And then it would be Cohen's job and Weisselberg's job to go reverse engineer the value of the assets to try to achieve the value that the crooked boss wanted him to achieve. But what he is representing very, very clearly, my understanding, Dom, fraud. Fraud in the first degree.
Lots of fraud. Can't say Trump without fraud. Also, the other news, former President Donald Trump's chief of staff in the White House, Mark Meadows, has spoken with special counsel Jack Smith's team at least three times this year, including once before a federal grand jury, which came only after Smith granted Meadows immunity to testify under oath, according to sources being reported at ABC News. Now, I know what
a lot of pushback on the ABC News reporting. In fact, Meadows' attorney said, you know, believe it if you want to, but I don't find it credible. A lot of pushback on the ABC News reporting, and everyone else reporting this story is putting that little precursor out there. But what I would say, I heard Joyce Vance last night on MSNBC say there are effectively two different types of immunity he may have been granted. He could have been granted a limited immunity, effectively, that his own testimony could not be used against him, but that rules out the Fifth. That precludes him from failing to give testimony before the grand jury. And then there's another kind of immunity, more of a negotiated immunity, if I understood it, Dom. And I'm less clear, and Joyce Vance did not clearly know from the ABC News reporting that's, again, been pushed back on, what sort of immunity specifically was granted to Mark Meadows. But to date, he has not been indicted, not in the D.C. deal. And I'm here in D.C. now, and I don't hear any rumblings from Jack Smith's office that he has been indicted yet. But, of course, he is one of the 18 co-defendants in the Fulton County and the Fawnee Willis, Dom.
One of the remaining 14, because four have already pled guilty and are now cooperating with Fawnee Willis.
And I also see there is reporting today Fawnee Willis has offered plea deals to at least six other co-defendants.
Yeah.
Probably Mark Meadows amongst them, but
excellent.
Who knows?
Excellent.
Who knows?
Line them up, knock them down. By the time it's all said and done, it's only going to be Trump and Giuliani at that table.
You think those will be the final two? I mean, Jenna Ellis, I think while we were off the air, while I was traveling yesterday, I think Jenna Ellis took her turn to plead guilty, Dom. And I think her crime was, what, fraudulently filing court documents or filing documents she knew to be wrong. And I assume that's a misdemeanor charge. They continue to seemingly plead to the slap on the wrist in regards to the Trump co-defendants. But, Dom, I think the good times are going to end for those that plead early and for those that plead late.
According to the AP, Ellis pleaded guilty to one felony count of aiding and abetting false statements and writings. So, yeah, it's still a felony. And she feels really, really bad about it as a lawyer and as a Christian. She feels really bad. She feels bad. But maybe you just can't, you know, ask for forgiveness from the judge and be forgiven. You guys got to go to your church for that, Jenna.
Well, the felonious pleading could preclude her from practicing law, Dom. Could preclude her from doing her chosen profession. And Michael Cohen, I think part of the representation of Alina Haba, A-L-I-N-A, however you say it, Haba, the Trump lawyer in the fraud trial, is Michael Cohen effectively, as a convicted felon, is no longer able to practice his vocation. So his new vocation is really, he's in the Trump trashing business. And he's living, doing media hits and as a contributor on different things.
Yeah.
But without Trump, that effectively he has no vocation any longer because of his prior felonious actions, he's no longer eligible to practice law.
Well, what does that even mean?
Like
without
most of the
Trump.
Other Trump lawyers.
Well, what does that even mean without Trump? I mean, Trump is still Trump. Trump's there. Trump's not president, but Trump's still here. And the guy worked for Trump, and he could trash the guy as much as he wants. As long as someone wants to hear it and bring him around, okay. But there's no, I mean, if Trump died today or was whisked off the earth somehow, right? Michael Cohen would still have something to say about Donald Trump. So I'm not clear what that's supposed to mean.
Well, maybe it's a prelude to the fact that every single one of the attorneys, now we got Sidney Powell, now we got Cheese Bro, and now we've got Jenna Ellis, have all pled, right?
Yes.
And if she is somehow disbarred because of her pleading to a felony count, Dom, I can see a very similar defense being put on to what was put on against Michael Cohen. While his only vocation, because he's a felon, is
Trump. That's always going to be the case in a RICO proceeding like this. You know what I mean? Everyone's charged, you know? And then some are going to plead, some are going to flip. Well, then what are you pleading to? What are you flipping to? Oh, yeah, I did it. And then what? Trump's attorneys, when he's the only guy left. Oh, look, they're all lying. Everyone else is lying? And Donald Trump is the victim of this grand conspiracy? No, you were part of the conspiracy, Trump. That's why they came at you with RICO. That's why 4 of the 18 have flipped. And according to Crute, another 6 potentially could flip as well.
Well, that's not Crute's reporting. I saw that elsewhere. We'd never lie to you. You're listening to the greatest radio show ever.
If you can't quote your source, I'm quoting you. Crute said it.
I'll take that. But I saw it reported elsewhere because I was busting my ass on the Hill trying to bring you a House Speaker race that I never thought would bring us Mike Johnson. And, we brought you Mark Pocan. I'm going to bring you Bill Press soon. But if you got your thoughts, right now would be a great time for a phone call. 844-967-2789. Crute Does DC. More Devil's Advocates. Happier Happy Hour.
60% of the time, they're right every time. The Devil's Advocates.
And welcome back to the Devil's Advocates radio show. Phone lines are open. You can join us at 844-967-2789. Our pal, Bill Press, he's a podcaster, he's a pundit, he's a prognosticator, and most importantly, he's a good friend of the Devil's Advocates. He's going to join Crute in the hotel in D.C. Crute, on the road. Crute does D.C. Once again, 844-967-2789.
I am preparing for Bill Press' imminent arrival at this time. Dom, I was also checking out the text line. Andrew from Verona asked, did Mark Pocan, I assume he means, at least offer you a couple two-tree beers? Yeah. Too bad Van Orden isn't in town. I've heard his office is a go-to spot to get sloshed. Nice. There is also a text out here on the WAUK line. Kind of feels like a shotgun speakership.
Right.
This Mike Johnson, you know, it wasn't anybody's first choice or second choice or third choice. But by the fourth time through, Dom, he became the choice. Someone else also said, so his mother got knocked up at 17 in high school. How very Christian. I don't know if that's true or not. Jeff from Sherwood is my source, Dom.
Thank you, Michael.
You can be our source at 844-96-PARTY. Crute does DC. I got Bill Press flipping me off through the hotel glass right now. Bill is on the scene. He'll be joining us here on the air very, very shortly.
Phone calls in while we have the time. Wisco Paul, you are up. Welcome, sir. What do you got for us?
Hey, thanks for taking my call, Devils. Trump is now the Speaker of the House.
Yeah,
right. Yeah, this could end in disaster. I can't see anything good happening. I wish I could think of a positive thing, but there is none. So I don't.
Well, I mean, I would say this, the positive thing, at least my understanding is he's presented, the new speaker has presented perhaps an opportunity to extend the current funding through maybe the end of the year, maybe through April. So at least in that regard, it doesn't seem like they're imminently going to shut it down again. Who knows what happens between, now and then. But I mean, at least there's someone there to help conduct the business, Paul. I mean, even if it's bad business and it can be rejected by a president, if any sort of actual legislation gets out, but they at least they can get the resolution to support Israel out, Paul.
A key word there was someone. He's someone. Right. I don't know who he is. Someone. If not, it's just the point. You got to be able to. Actually, this guy, I heard it said, is Jim Jordan in a suit coat. So they could have. What I'm trying to say here is the GOP can do better than this. If you want to become the Trump party, go.
Well, they
for
are.
It. That's all I can say.
Yeah, Paul. I mean, that's exactly.
Are you
they
sure
are.
They can do better than this? Because
he seems very.
Prior example demonstrates they can.
And he is very representative, Paul, of what the megas are. He's Mega Mike, man. I mean, we talked about the anti-LGBTQ, right? The anti-abortion. He's all the things, the Christian nationalism. He is all the things that MAGA wants to be. So in that regard, he absolutely represents what MAGA is. Now, what's gone, the Kinzingers, the Mitt Romney types, they're long gone, man. This is the MAGA party. And I was talking to Todd Alba earlier. It's like, are we actually seeing the Republican Party disintegrate before our eyes? And perhaps we are. But in the meantime, they'll be led by Mega Mike Johnson. Thanks for the call, Wisco, 844-967-2789. Catherine from Madison, you're next. Welcome, Catherine. What do you got for us?
Hey, Catherine.
Hi, guys. Hi. I have a auxiliary thought. It's really not, it's just something I was thinking about. And I've never heard of this guy, Mike Johnson. There's so many people in the news. I just don't. He's flown under my radar. And I'm wondering how much he's going to stand up to the scrutiny that the person who's second in line for the presidency now, people are going to be looking at his financial stuff, personal stuff, family stuff. I don't think he's really had that much scrutiny before. I just wonder what's going to happen with that.
Hopefully he holds up better than Clarence Thomas, because I saw today from a Senate committee that Clarence Thomas never repaid a $267,000 RV loan. That must have been a hell of a sweet RV and a hell of a sweet deal if you don't have to pay it back.
If you don't pay it back, it's not really a loan, isn't it? It's just like they're giving you money if you don't pay it back. Hey, I'd rather owe it to you forever than never pay you. Catherine, I think you make a great point. You know, what kind of scrutiny was he under? But I think ultimately, we see the reporting coming out. We know the kinds of things that he has said. Now, whether or not there's any shenanigans, like as Crute mentioned, refers to Clarence Thomas and his, you know, $250,000 payoff. We don't know that kind of stuff yet, but we know policy-wise, based on the committees he was in, based on the reporting of what his comments have been on multitude of issues, we know exactly where he is in that regard. Thanks for the call, Catherine. 844-967-2789. Oh, go ahead, Curdy.
No. I was just nodding along with you for a change. I agree with you, Dominic.
Right. Seeing this reporting at the roster, Clarence Thomas never repaid a millionaire friend's $267,000 loan, which the Supreme Court justice used to buy a 40-foot luxury motor coach, Senate investigators announced on Wednesday. Healthcare magnate Anthony Welters told the Senate Finance Committee he forgave the RV loan after 5 years of receiving payments on the interest, but not the principal. Here's a quote from
Does that? What bank? I mean, unless the guy is financially destitute, is the Supreme Court justice financially destitute? And would that not constitute a significant gift, Dom?
Yeah.
I mean, that is actually a taxable gift.
Yes.
Gifts of larger than, I believe it's $16,000 per year, perhaps per spouse. So he could forgive, $32,000, $34,000 a year tax-free to the giver. But a guy had to go pay taxes for the right to forgive this loan to Clarence Thomas.
We now know that Justice Thomas had up to $267,230 in debt forgiven and never reported it on his ethics forms. Senate Finance Committee Chair Ron Wyden, a Democrat from Oregon, said,
I wonder if he put it on his tax forms.
Wyden called on Thomas to specify exactly how much of the debt he paid and whether the loan was reported on tax returns. I have also directed the committee to share our findings with the Judiciary Committee to evaluate the ethics and implications of this disclosure. Damn, man. I mean, what? No, nothing to see here. We don't need any sort of oversight. We don't need anything that all their judges in the federal court system have to abide by. No. We'll self-regulate. But we'll let you know if there's a problem. And apparently getting $250,000 to, you know, pump around the country in an 40-foot RV, that's nothing that you little people need to worry about. It's all good.
You know, I was walking by the Supreme Court, the literal Supreme Court yesterday, Dom, and I walked Mrs. Crute by, and she was taken aback. There's some strong odor, and I'm not sure if it's flowers or, you know, backwano. I'm not sure exactly, but my take is, you might be allergic to the corruption of Clarence Thomas, and that's what you're smelling right now, baby. Crudy does DC Devils Advocates, doing it like only we can, and I got a fine guest. He's walking over right now, the incomparable Bill Press. He's a pundit. He's a podcaster. He's a friend of ours. He joins me next, live at the Royal Sonesta, kind of a swanky place right here on Capitol
Hill. Can't believe they let you in, Crudy.
I'm wearing shorts.
Highs around 67. For Civic Media, I'm meteorologist Derek Height. Currently, it's 61 degrees.
Weather in a Moment is brought to you by Chad's Design Build. Building a better world, one remodeled home at a time. Reach out today by going to chadsdesignbuild.com to learn more. Again, that's chadsdesignbuild.com.
You are never far away from your favorite radio station. We're always streaming on TuneIn and the Civic Media app. And if you missed your favorite show or game, listen to a podcast of it anytime on the app or our website, civicmedia.us.
Broadcasting from Civic Media Global Headquarters on State Street, this is...
I would have gotten away with it, too, if it wasn't for those meddling devil's advocates.
Welcome back to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show, a whopper of a Wednesday. I assure you, Crute does DC, and now I've brought along a friend of ours. You can see him. He's Bill Press. He's a pundit. He's a podcaster.
Hey, Bill.
Well, hold on one second, Bill. Are we hearing him okay?
All right.
Are we hearing Bill okay? Can you hear Bill?
There we go. Now you can hear me. Yeah, that's it. That's the old trick, turning somebody's microphone off.
Yeah, rookie Crute. Yeah,
usually you wait until they say something outrageous to do that. He did it right. So, you know, so, Dom, what can I say? You know, you and I meet in Plaza Verona, in Rome, and Crute and I meet in the hotel lobby in Washington, D.C.
It's a good life, Bill. It's a good life, man.
Now, did they have a giant beaver at the Roman fountains? Because there's a giant beaver over by the elevators here.
No, instead we had some of the most beautiful statues and fountains in all of Rome. Bernini himself came to our little dinner. Good to see you guys. Welcome to D.C.
Well, thank
and
you,
I mean,
Bill.
It's certainly good that you're here for such an exciting day. I mean, I'm beyond enthusiasm that we have a new Speaker of the House.
I
mean,
I was looking for like black smoke or white smoke out of the Capitol dome. How did they make that announcement?
Well, there was a black smoke because they were burning documents. You know, he got the job for two reasons, right? I mean, this is really, first of all, 3 weeks making total fools of themselves, which I got to say, for this gang, it's not hard for them to make total fools of themselves because they're such idiots anyway. So Johnson got the job not because anybody knows who he is. You know what? This is my job, right? 24 hours a day, I'm doing politics. I never freaking heard of this guy. I never heard of Mike Johnson.
Mike Johnson.
Before. No.
I'd seen him once. He looks like a little like Cameron from Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
Yeah, he looks like a nerd. He is a nerd, right?
Well, he looks like a Republican nerd.
Republican nerd. Sorry. Yeah. So anyhow, he didn't get the job because he's well known. He didn't get the job because he's qualified. He's been there 8 years. He's never run anything. He's never chaired a committee. He's never been in charge of anything. And now he's freaking Speaker of the House. I mean, it's crazy. He got the job for two reasons. Number one, because Republicans were just sick and tired. They got fatigued. They've been mud wrestling for 3 weeks. And they finally just said, one of the Republicans says, we'll take a live body. And I think the first one to walk by was Mike Johnson. So I said, all right, I'll do it. Number one. Number two, he really got the job because Donald Trump said, he's my guy.
Is that it? I had seen that Trump killed Ember's nomination.
Ember.
And it's... But speaker wannabe candidacy, but
yeah. So he said, "I'm not going to support endorse Mike Johnson because I don't want to look like I'm dictating, but I strongly encourage everybody to vote for Mike Johnson." Yeah, as if that's a big difference. But I want to come back to what you just said. This is what I find unbelievable. We got the House of Representatives. This is an independent branch of the government, the Congress, right? They got a guy they voted. They want him to be our next speaker, Tom Emmer. He's been the whip. He's been in charge. He's the guy who knows his way around, right? And Trump says, no, I don't want him because he at one time said, oh, he voted for Biden. He voted to accept Biden as the next president after Biden won the election by 7 million votes. So Donald Trump dictated to this Republicans in the House, no, you cannot.
But Bill, let me.
You cannot take that guy. Imagine. So just think about the breakdown of our government when the Congress would ask a former president, is this guy okay? Now, we voted for him, but, you know, hey, Donnie, baby, is this guy okay with you? It is appalling. It's outrageous.
My thought was, it's not so much that Trump can make a candidacy as he can kill a candidacy.
Exactly, yes.
He killed Emmer, but he could not raise Jim Jordan. And, in fact, with his fraud trial going on, he seemed sort of, you know, above it all or at least away from it all.
He couldn't raise Jim Jordan. But let me see. Mike Jordan, no relation, right, Johnson would not have the job if Donald Trump had said, no, he's no good. Would not have the job. So it's a big day in Washington. Hey, Don.
Hey, folks are listening to the Devil's Advocates radio show. Bill Press, he's a podcaster, he's a pundit, he's a prognosticator, he's a friend of ours. Great to see you, Bill. Wish I was there with you. Looks awesome in D.C. and historic day. You know, I like your point about Mr. Johnson. Nobody knows him. Perhaps that's why he got the job. And, of course, he's a Trump sycophant. And, of course, he's anti-LGBTQ. He checks all the mega boxes. I think it was Gates referring to him as Mega Mike, man. I mean, this is Donald Trump's guy. This is Donald Trump's party. Bill, is there anything left of the original grand old party? I was just drove through Ripon the other day where the birthplace of the Republican Party. Is it dying? Is it dead? How do you see this Republican Party moving forward past 2024?
You know what? Too bad you're not here, because tomorrow we could go over to the Smithsonian Natural History Museum. They got two great new exhibits. The first one is the dinosaur exhibit. And then right next to it is the Republican Party exhibit. They're one and the same. The Republican Party is dead. It is dead. And, you know, look, there are guys out there, by the way, whom I admire. And I've had them on my podcast, and I'm sure you have too. You don't like me to mention Charlie Sykes, but I will, because the stuff he's doing today is good. Just forget his background for now. Bill Kristol, Stuart Stevens, these guys, the Lincoln Project, Liz Cheney, yeah. Adam Kinzinger. There are a handful, but I've talked to a lot of them, and I've asked them, is there any chance, right, that the Republican Party, which is a party, smaller government, lower taxes, you know, all that, right, that party could ever reinstate itself, right, ever come back? And they've all told me, no way. It's no way. It is now the MAGA party. So there are two parties today, the Democratic Party and the MAGA party. There is no mainstream Republican Party. And that, look, I'm a Democrat. I've been a Democrat all my life. But I think we need at least two choices.
At least two parties.
Right? Yeah. God. So it's and that's what we're seeing. Again, you know, there's a little bit of, they call them, what is it? There's a few spineless mainstream Republicans in the House.
Rhinos? That's what they call them.
They call them rhinos. Squishies. Squishies is the word I was looking
squishy.
For. Squishies. Because there may be 20 of them out of 219, but they always fold. You know what I mean? So with that slim a margin, they could control if one of them would stand up. One of them could have stood up in the last 3 weeks and said, you know what? I'm willing to make a deal with Hakeem Jeffries to keep the House open. We're not going to fold. We're not going to give away everything. But I'm willing to say, okay, we'll stick to that budget deal that Kevin McCarthy made with Joe Biden. We'll stick with aid to Ukraine, which most Americans want. And we'll get rid of this stupid rule that says you can throw out the speaker. One person at any time can, you know, call for a motion to dismiss the speaker for any reason whatsoever. Maybe those three little things, it would have been easy for Democrats to agree with, and we would have been in business, right? Now we got this mess.
Bill Press, I had a brush with greatness in you today, but I also had a brush with Lauren Boebert coming back from Capitol Hill, and I look at her as perhaps one of the personifications of the MAGA movement. You
did
know,
she so, grab your crotch?
She did not.
Oh,
all right. Hey, fair question. Fair question.
She did give me a look, Bill, that I could only interpret as you know, an invitation.
The last time I saw Lauren Boebert was when she was at the Beetlejuice concert with her with her drag queen Squeeze.
At the theater.
Yeah. Yes. That's sorry. Distract you.
She looked classy-ish today. Classy with the K. Anyways, it was the point I was trying to get to, other than name dropping the Lauren Boebert walking around in a prom dress today, is, Bill, do you think there is a dying of this MAGA movement, or do you think the fact that they picked the speaker gives all this craziness a reprieve for a minute, and then it's all going to come crashing down upon the country again?
Wait a minute. Have you looked at the polls in the Republican primary lately?
Oh, yeah. Trump's up big.
I mean, he's ahead by like 40, 45 points over anybody. So you think I don't see any sign at all that the MAGA movement is dying. The MAGA movement is, I think, stronger than ever. Trump gets stronger than ever. But here's the I'm convinced. After Trump is gone, and he will be gone.
Yeah.
You've heard me say before, I've said on your show, I don't think he'll be the nominee. Because
Dom says it all the time, but I don't listen to him either, Bill.
Okay. Well, it's, you know, look what happened today. He got slammed today again in the court. $10,000. The judge said, you know, hey, dude, I told you not to put this stuff up. You
did. $10,000, that's Dominic's bar tab, Bill. Come on, that's chump change.
All right, but beyond that, though, Bill, we talk about, you know, the movement. And perhaps it's strong within the megas. It's strong. I don't know that it's growing. In fact, I think it's you know, declining to a degree. And here's why I would suggest that.
Go ahead. Yeah.
You got the megas rolling over, man. You got Jenna Ellis. You got Kenneth Cheesebro. You got the Kraken lady, Sidney Powell. You got attorneys for Donald Trump admitting in federal court that they lied. You got Fox News admitting that they lied. I mean, everybody following the
when did
the
Fox News admit it?
when they got caught and they have to pay the bill. So here's the point. Don't you think that at some point all the confirmed, factual, provable lies that they admitted to themselves will eventually soak into some of the megas?
No.
Damn it.
No.
A definitive answer. He gave you a firm no.
I was just going to say, look, those are all, and we ought to talk about that. That is extremely important, what's happened in the last couple of days, right? You got Ken Cheesehead, you got Jenna Ellis, and you've got now Mark Meadows, right? And you got Michael Cohen on the witness stand. I'm wondering when Rudy Giuliani's going to flip, but I'm not sure they will. But that's going to happen. That's going to hurt Trump. That's why I think you and I think Trump won't be the nominee, because I think it's going to come down on him, and he's going to be indicted soon, and before the election, before the convention. But the MAGA base will still, I think, stay strong. They'll still, I mean, Jesus, last night Donald Trump compared himself to Nelson Mandela.
I mean, if he's got to go to jail for everybody, he's willing to do that. I would accept that. Trump, absolutely go to jail for me. I would appreciate that.
And these people believe him when he says he's the next Nelson Mandela.
Well,
you know?
Trump also said it would take Jesus Christ to win the speakership. And Mike Johnson, you're no Jesus Christ.
And neither is Donald Trump.
No, I suspect he's not. Bill Press, my fine guest here at the Royal Sonesta, Capitol Hill, Crute does D.C. Bill, always great to see you, sir. And
welcome to Capitol Hill. You know, I live on Capitol Hill.
Do you? This is my first. When Dom and I came, last time I was in this town, we came for the Trump inauguration. We stayed for the Women's March. And I have not been back to D.C. since, Bill.
And we broadcast from Bill's studio at the time. We smoked.
Yeah, we had a great time.
I was going to say, didn't we broadcast together at the time?
We
did. Absolutely.
We did.
Right.
I will confess to the broadcasting aspect.
And remember, there were more people at the Women's March than there were at Donald Trump's inauguration.
It was amazing.
Fact.
I was telling that story just yesterday when Trump said, it looks like a million people. I got to tell you, we were on ground level. We were at using Ron Johnson's tickets at the inauguration. And I'm looking back at the the Washington Monument. And that was the biggest crowd I'd ever seen from ground level. But the very next day, when you were in the streets with all the women in the pink hats, And that started, there was no march. There was a movement. There were millions. That was an enormous crowd. I've never seen anything like it in my life. He's Bill Press. He's sticking around. More Devil's Advocates. Crute does DC. And I got a friend with me. He's Bill Press. We'll come back. One final segment, at least for today.
And then it's quitting time. Folks, we are the Devil's Advocates. Stick around. One final segment. We'll be right back.
Got a wife in Chino, baby, and one Cherokee. First one say she got my child, but it don't look like me. I said I'm running, but I took my time. A friend of the devil is a friend of mine. I get home before daylight, just might get some sleep tonight.
The Devil's Advocates, political commentary from the back of the class.
And we are back. Thank you for listening to the Devil's Advocates radio show, our last segment of the day. But make sure you stick around. There's more coming on the Civic Media Network. Maggie Dawn, the Maggie Dawn Show, coming up in the 6 o'clock hour.
Dom, it's soon going to be drinks and victuals for Bill Press and myself, but we're going to do a little more radio here today.
We're going first class, too. We're going down to the Palm. Yeah, I already called ahead. I said, have the martinis ready and and put that New York steak on the grill.
Oh, man, you know, you guys are killing me, man.
That sounds like my kind of dinner, victuals, and cocktails. Bill Press, so glad that you made a little time for us tonight in D.C., Now, you got a column coming out tomorrow. Let me ask you, a little preview. What's going to publish at the Hill in your name?
Well, we're
the House Speaker, right? How could you ignore that?
Tomorrow's column is a column I write for the Tribune Syndicate.
Oh, my bad.
No, that's right. But you're right. I'm going to write that. I'm already started writing about Tom Johnson. We've already talked a little bit about, you got a flavor of what I got to say, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That this is Trump's guy and that's all. I think the headline I put on it is Trump's a marionette, and the GOP speaker, they elect a puppet, right. So, but anyway, my Hill column this week, I'm talking about. I had fun with this one. I pointed out, all right, the closer you get to 2024, the more that all the issues that the Republicans wanted to run on are kind of fading. Like they were going to say, we're going to run on the economy. Hey, dude, the economy is pretty strong right now. Everything is up that should be up. Everything's down that should be down. You got inflation's down. Gas prices are down. So then they say, well, we're going to run on immigration. Yeah, well, you know, the border's not great, but the border wasn't great under Trump either, right? I mean,
they forget that part, Bill.
They forget that part. So that's, they can't, and I said, they certainly can't run on, we're the party that knows how to get things done or to govern, right? So the only thing they got left is, we're going to run on, Biden's too damn old.
Yeah.
The problem is Biden doesn't cooperate. Biden goes and walks a picket line. Biden goes to Kyiv. Biden goes to Tel Aviv. He's the only president who's gone to a war zone, and he went twice, right? Not controlled by the U.S. military. So Republicans kind of left basically with nothing, right? Instead, they got their guy who I think is losing it.
I think Trump's losing it. I think that might be true. I thought the entire party was losing it, but let me ask you. I asked Pocan this question earlier today. now
you
that
mean
we've
our honorable Congressman Mark Pocan, good friend of all of ours.
I call him Mark. but here's the question: these Republicans have elected a speaker, but to govern or to shut down the government? Because Bill, we're going to find out really, really quick if this last month has been chaotic. What happens if Speaker Johnson leads the charge to shut down the government?
It shuts down. If he leads the charge, it shuts down. I cannot believe that coming out of this 3 weeks of monumental national embarrassment that Republicans themselves have to, even these guys up here, they've gone, they admit they look like total asses, right? I can't admit they're going to come out of that and shut down the government. Having said that,
I'm telling you, Lauren Boebert had a twinkle in her eye today, Bill.
Having said that, I believe that's what they will do. And then, Now, the only thing is, you know, the more they screw up, the better it is for Democrats. I mean, I can't imagine that we don't have the best chance of taking back the House that we've ever had after people have seen this gang that can't, it's not the gang that can't shoot straight. I mean, they can't even, I don't know.
Is that part of the reason, the dysfunction in the Congress? I saw Hakeem Jeffries before the speaker vote happened on the floor. He was actually on C-SPAN with Ari Melber, a strange happening, but I watched it a little bit today.
Yeah.
And he said effectively, you know, the last time there was a midterm election and it was a referendum on the president, Dems lost 63 seats, and that didn't happen this time. So these margins, because of the outperformance of the Democrats in the midterms and Joe Biden's first term, because of the fear of perhaps these Republicans, they don't have a governing majority effectively. They're, and when you got eight crazies or more, it's easy to lose some small faction and lose the whole House speakership, Bill.
Yeah. I want to go back to something. Dom mentioned this a little bit earlier, but the more we learn about Mike Johnson, I'll have some of my column tomorrow. I mean, this guy's he may be quiet, right? But he's dangerous. I mean, he's as extreme right as Jim Jordan. Somebody called him today, he's Jordan with a jacket and a smile. So he's as crazy as Jordan, right? But he is, like, he's for a national ban on abortion. He believes that we should recriminalize homosexuality. Get rid of the Lawrence v. Wright decision. And same-sex marriage, absolutely. So he would roll back everything, right? I mean, and he's Speaker of the House. He's as extreme as any of those, John McCain used to call them wacko birds, right?
Yeah.
It's just that he doesn't look like it, right? And he doesn't spout like it, and he's not on cable TV all the time.
Not yet, Bill, but he will
That's
be.
Right.
And I hope that when he goes around, everyone asks him, inquires about these very specific questions. I mean,
How about last night?
He led the effort to shut down or to overturn the government, to reject Joe Biden's victory. And someone asked him that yesterday, and all these Republicans were mocking him.
Boo,
shut up. Yeah. Some old lady, Virginia Fox, elderly congresswoman, was just like yelling at him.
Shut up.
It was just terrible. I think to myself, really? I mean, this is what the guy did. All the reporters is asking a question about his actions during that time frame, Bill, and they couldn't even bring themselves to address it. And then what? He has a press conference without taking questions from the press. It sounds more like propaganda to me, Bill.
But let's come back to that, right? The question he was asked: do you accept the 2020 results of the 2020 election? He would not answer it. You know why? Because if he answers that question, Trump would not let him be speaker. But think how appalling that is, that a member of the House of Representatives, any Republican Congress person, that's the question they have to ask. And I say, if they can't answer that question saying, yes, I accept it, then throw them the hell out of office, all of them.
Amen.
Bill Press, pundit, podcaster, columnist, friend of the devil's advocates, thanks to you. Thank you to Mark. That's what I call my Congressman Mark Pocan, the honorable. Hey. Thank you all for listening. Crute does D.C. edition.
Come back to D.C. You know,
love having
you here.
I'm not leaving yet. I got one more show here. I'm doing it tomorrow. Stick around. Maggie Dunn is next. And then a special live from D.C. edition of the Empowered Caregiver National Caregiver convention going on here at the Royal Sonesta. Liza Hellenbrand will bring you all the coverage, and I'm ducking in on that show as well. I'm making a special appearance after victuals and cocktails here with Bill Press in D.C.
All right.
Thank you all for listening.
Thanks, Bill. Have one for me.